So how smart do you think a nuclear scientist could be? Especially one who has a successful career in semiconductor technology and with several patents related to integrated circuits to their name. Not to mention an advisor to top-notch multinational companies. Yet this highly accomplished 59-year-old isn't being allowed a seat on the board of directors despite holding an 8.5% stake in the 37,000 crore, $5 billion Murugappa Group's holding company, Ambadi Investments, in which her late father, M.V. Murugappan, was once the patriarch. Allegedly because Dr. Valli Arunachalam is a woman. This family of only women, Dr. Valli, her sister Velachi, and their mother M.V. Valli Murugappan, are being denied entry to this males-only club for the last 3 years, ever since their father's demise. According to Valli, several board members of the holding company Ambadi Investments had promised her, "Yes, we will agree to your nomination as a non-executive director." But in the September 2020 board meeting, 91.37% shareholders, largely comprising of her uncles and cousins, rejected her. 2 weeks later, Valli Arunachalam sent legal notices to members of the Murugappa family and the management of Ambadi Investments.
"It was always our wish that family issues remain within the family, but it seems they are more concerned about protecting draconian practices."
Based in Chennai, the Murugappa Group was founded in 1900 by Diwan Bahadur Murugappa Chettiar as a money lending and banking business. It now has over 24 businesses, from farm to finance, textiles, rubber plantations, insurance, stockbroking, with 9 listed companies. The website of this conglomerate features a list of the founders and a family tree, but it doesn't feature a single woman. According to Valli, in a patriarchal family like the Murugappas, the sons are groomed from a very early age to take charge of business, while daughters are expected to accept the ways of patriarchy without question. The consequences for not accepting these traditions is they are ostracized and are considered unwomanly and arrogant. But in some Indian societies, the roles are reversed. In India's northern state of Meghalaya, the Khasi and Garo communities follow a matrilineal system where women in the family inherit everything, not men. Even Karnataka's Bund community follows a similar system called Aliya Santana, a tradition they inherited from King Butala Pandya, who ruled Tulu Nadu and introduced this in 77 AD. While Kerala has much the same tradition, Maru Makkathayam, meaning nephews and nieces. This practice probably came into being during the Chera Chola Wars of the Second Chera Empire at the end of the 10th century, where men who went to fight had no certainty when they would return or whether they would return at all. Possibly as a result of this, a system of polyandry developed among communities such as Nayars and Izhawas in ancient Malabar, where a woman enjoyed conjugal relations with more than one man. So as to protect the inheritance rights of a child conceived outside of matrimonial bounds, the mother was considered a better guardian to the lineage, Thavazi. Also, in the absence of the male, the responsibility to propagate the clan name and traditions fell on the woman. Men eventually ended up abandoning their rights of inheritance, as it seemed to make a more practical sense. An interesting spin-off of this practice was that since women became more important to the clan, there was no question of aborting or killing a girl child. And therefore we see that Kerala and states which at some point practiced this system has the best sex ratio in the country. However, Kerala banned the matrilineal structure through the Joint Family System Abolition Act 1975, giving proportionate rights to all inheritors. Therefore, the Supreme Court's August 2020 verdict to grant Hindu women equal rights in their ancestral property was already in practice in Kerala from way before. Women are known for their managerial skills, and those who have inherited and run large businesses when there were no male members around have done so competently. The Reddy sisters of Apollo carved out niche roles to diversify and scale into India's largest healthcare conglomerate. Parle Agro's Chauhan sisters took over the business and successfully expanded it after a family separation. In both instances, the daughters were involved in the business from the beginning and picked up skills and knowledge by working alongside professionals and family members. There are some path-breaking daughter-in-laws too. In the 1930s, Sumati Murarji was married into the business family that owns Sindhya's steam navigation company. when the Great Depression and financial crisis hit India, she took over the reins of the company in the absence of her father-in-law, growing and expanding it, and is accredited as the first woman of Indian shipping and the first ever woman in the world to head an organization of ship owners. Simone Tata moved to India from Switzerland when she married Naval Tata, founding the cosmetic company Lakme, which was her brainchild to cater to the needs of the burgeoning middle-class Indian women in the 1960s. After the death of her husband, Anu Aga took over the boiler company Thermax and in 2004 passed on the reins to her daughter. Most independent women who get to the top of their profession and achieve leadership roles speak of supportive homes.
I owe my success to my family.
At the bottom strata of society, women work really hard as every penny is needed. As they climb the income ladder, the overall socio-cultural setup creates obstacles to stop their women from working as false egos come into play. A stay-at-home wife is a status symbol signifying prosperity. My son earns enough money, why should his wife work? As a result, female labor force participation in India has fallen from 33% in the early 90s to 23% today. One reason is that a greater proportion of 15 to 25 year olds are now in schools and colleges instead of working in the fields, and that's a good thing. But despite rising female education, in urban areas, it's still among the lowest in the world. At 16%, barely above the Muslim belt stretching from Morocco to Pakistan, ranking India a deplorable 112 out of 153 countries in the World Bank's Gender Inequality Index. While an impressive 24% of business today's most powerful women are associated with their father's or spouse's family-owned businesses, altogether in 2019, just 15% of Nifty 500 firm's board members were women, and fewer than 5% had women as CEOs. Under the Indian Companies Act, a firm with a paid-up share capital of 100 crore or with an annual turnover of 300 crore must have at least one woman on its board. But Ambadi Investment share capital was just 2.44 crore and their revenue 83 crore, both below the threshold of the Act. However, Murugappa Group's listed company Coromandel Fertilizers, EID Parry, Ramco Systems and Ramco Cement all have female board members. A somewhat similar battle is being played out in the $11 billion Hinduja family, where the eldest daughter of patriarch S.P. Hinduja is allegedly being thwarted by his three brothers.
The fight for gender equality gets tougher for women in storied Indian business families because of the money power they hold.
The fact that this makes news today clearly shows that disenfranchising women is not as common as before, nor will the women take it meekly like they did. Bizbo's limerick. Valli Arunachalam wants her rightful place on a board that once her father graced, but patriarchy rules and only boys' schools to take over and run the family space. Subscribe to Bizbo and click on the bell icon to get notified whenever Bizbo releases a new video. Sources of all our information is listed in the video description section.